Okay, so like I said, I'm going to keep the introductions very short, but it's my honor to introduce our first speaker, Professor Dimitris Bertsimas from the Operations Research Center at MIT. He's going to tell us about artificial intelligence that can be interpreted. Dimitris.
Morning, thank you for coming. So it's a funny talk for an optimization, a funny title, no? Interpretable AI optimization, where is it? So bear with me for a bit. So just to motivate. So before coming here, actually, I was a bit lost and I went to another place, the Friend Engineering Center. And there was a conference there that said, I forget the exact title, said problems of AI. And also advertised 400 members. So I talked a little bit with the participants. It was a random encounter, but it's relevant to the presentation. So everybody these days talks about deep learning, yeah? So, so it's undeniable that artificial intelligence, and particularly deep learning, have made significant progress in many areas, computer vision, automatic translation, voice recognition, that are today affecting society. There is a conference, Alexa conference, that Amazon is organizing, and there are about 7,000 people going. So definitely the society, you know, the NIPS conference, for example, attracts 3,000 people, and in 10 minutes, all the tickets are gone. So it's undeniable that society, not only scientific community, the society has taken, has observed something is happening. However, in my view, deep learning suffers from lack of interpretability. What do I mean by that? Suppose, so in the summer, I have a friend in Zurich who owns a Tesla S model that has a driverless capacity. So I was curious, so I drove it in that fashion for about half an hour, and everything was fine. I was very impressed. But suppose this driverless car is involved in an accident with loss of life. Who is at fault? The driver, the passenger, or the algorithm? And in particular, can society tolerate of not knowing? I mean, if there is an accident involving airplanes, it might take years, but in the end, we try to answer what happened. So it's early stages, but it is my view that society in the future will not tolerate not understanding things that matter in life, like life itself. Or here's another example. So let's say, I don't know about Princeton, but I know many other universities where they utilize algorithms for deciding admissions. If you have, let's say, tens of thousands of students, I mean, it's not scalable. I mean, you need some kind of help. So suppose a student is not selected for freshman admissions, even though the student has fantastic grades, activities, and so forth. Is it an adequate response from the admissions office in the university that an algorithm made the decision and we don't understand what the algorithm uses? I would say society will not tolerate not understanding things of this nature. You might disagree, but that's the perspective I took, and it's also based on my personal experience with healthcare that you will see in a minute throughout the talk. So in my view, interpretability matters. To give you the punchline, suppose you are a young person, we are full of young people in the audience, and let's say a male of some characteristics, the albumin level is 2.8 grams per deciliter, there is no sepsis, liver enzyme is 1.1 and so forth, somebody is diabetic, and there's a method that predicts mortality. And there's a black box that tells to a person, you have 26% probability of dying within the next year. And what is the first question that comes to my mind? Why? I mean, what is going on? I'm a young person, they don't die at that age. As opposed to an algorithm, forget about the details of the algorithm, that the message is the same, but at least we have a sense of understanding what the algorithm says. I would say the second is much more preferable than the first. Okay? Hopefully I motivate you that this is something to take a look at. And I would like to now connect with a hero of mine, Mr. Leo Breiman. Leo Breiman was a professor, had a very unusual career. He was a consultant. He finished Berkeley. He was a consultant for maybe 25 years, and then he became a professor at roughly around age 50 or so. And arguably, he did the best of his work after he came back, and in fact, some after retirement. So he wrote a paper, a book actually, in 1984, together with three other colleagues, called Classification and Regression Trees. CART, in short. Who here knows what CART is? Okay, after all, it's an optimization conference. Not too many people know it. You should, though, in my view. You will see why I believe that. So it is fair to say that CART, this book, had serious impact in the world. So this publication, I mean, not that citations is the most important thing in life, but they are positively correlated with impact. And this particular book has about 37,000 citations. 37,000 citations. How many papers in mathematical science works have more than 10,000 citations? Does anybody know? It's a lot or not so lot? What do you think, Amir?
How many have more than 10?
Yeah. It's under 20. So it's not, it's something to be impressed. I mean, it's not an easy thing to do. And I would like to illustrate this key logic because it's related with what I'm about to say. So this is actually a historic data set from 1936 by a famous statistician, Fisher. And this is a stylistic academic example. This is not a real world example, even though it uses real world data. And it says the following. It's a simple classification problem. I have, let's say, two types of flowers. They have scientific names of Setosa and Virginica. Let's call them red and green. Yeah? And these are physical characteristics of the flowers. This is the sepal length. This is the sepal width. So these are the red and this is the green. And what CART does is greedily goes over every dimension, in this case only two. It tries to partition the data in two pieces, either with horizontal or vertical partitions, in such a way that creates as homogeneous parts as possible. So for every possible choice, it selects in a greedy fashion the best possible. So this is the first partition, and you see on the right, all the points are green. So that's it's very pure partition, so you can stop. On the left, there is some ambiguity, so you continue, and now you create a partition of the space in a greedy fashion. So you will now label all coordinates in this upper left as red, and everything else as green. Yeah. And you can represent this by a tree. Yeah. Let's view it as a tree. It says is sepal length more or less than 575, that's the first partition. If the answer is yes, you say it's red. Otherwise, you check the second partition, and so you represent this partition in a tree fashion. Yeah? So that's, in rough ways, what Leo and his colleagues have done about 30 plus years ago. So there are the following statements. He says, so I quote from the book. He says, finally, another problem frequently mentioned by others, not by us, is that the tree procedure is only one step optimal and not overall optimal. If one would search over all possible partitions, the two results might be quite different. We don't address this problem here. At this stage of computer technology, an overall optimal tree growing procedure does not appear feasible for any reasonably sized data set. This was 1984. And in addition, he added something to which I agree, but on interpretability, trees receive an A+. So think about the way I understand this best. Is suppose you go to a doctor, and let's say you have fever. So typically, a typical dialogue with the doctor is, what is your fever today, sir? Let's say, is it more than 102? Yes. Well, what is your blood pressure? Is it above 170? Yes. So here's a test that you might, even though they don't consciously think they use a tree algorithm, I believe that in essence they do. More or less. It's not that they compute data and so forth. But in a way, it simulates their experience. And often, when I engage a dialogue with my personal physician, I definitely ask what would have happened if you said something different. So the motivation for this work is to basically use optimization, after all it is an optimization day event, to talk about some work that I have done with a doctoral student of mine who just graduated in June called Optimal Trees. The paper appeared in Machine Learning 2017. And what is the idea? Don't expect too many formulas in this talk, huh? So here's the idea. The idea is to formulate this problem from an optimization perspective. So let's see, what are the decisions? The decisions need to be, what are the hyperplanes? So what are, let's say, which variable are you going to split at what level and at what number? Is x5 less than 17? And you have to choose the 5 and the 17. And then you have to choose, as you have points, where the point will land, in which leaf, and you can, I mean, if you are reasonably knowledgeable in optimization, you can actually formulate this problem as an integer optimization problem, both the problem of classification, where each leaf requires a label, 0, 1, 2, 3, depending on how many classes you have, or regression, namely that at each point you have a y and you can run a linear regression in each leaf. So it's a piecewise linear function that you try to learn. Huh? In addition, it has another advantage. It has the advantage of, instead of using vertical and horizontal partitions, you can use hyperplanes. So what is a hyperplane? It is a1 x1 plus a2 x2, blah, blah, is less than b. So in the vertical and horizontal partitions, the a's are not, all of them are zero, except only one of them is equal to one. So in some ways, viewed from an optimization lens, the hyperplane problem is easier. Because because some of the variables are continuous as opposed to discrete. So with work, and in addition, when you have an optimization framework, you can also develop mathematical programming heuristics that can improve the key here is to avoid the greediness. So we have, through Jack's effort, we were able to scale this to about 1 million points and 10,000 variables, which is pretty respectable. In other words, there are applications outside of this realm, but it's not like we cannot solve quite a few of these problems. So that's roughly the scaling. And I outline again the decision, what variable to split on, which label to predict the region, and which region a point ends up with, whether a point is correctly classified. And as I mentioned, you can actually move in the direction of using hyperplanes. And like support vector machines, a very popular topic in the previous decades, is like a tree, but only in one side. So first, you can utilize support vector machines if you do this recursively, right? But this is an optimization setting that you try to put hyperplanes together. Okay? Any questions so far? Yes, sir.
You were saying you have to choose which variables to split on, but does the order that you split on also
matter? No, of course it does, but if you have a binary tree, so at a leaf in the tree, which in the way it specifies order, you have to say in that portion of the tree, what is the variable and what is the cut. Yeah? And then you have to put constraints that they are consistent with each other. Huh? So, you know. I'm not saying this is a trivial calculation, but you know. So I would like to make a remark. In machine learning, hopefully some people are here. So this is an NP-hard problem. Unfortunately, NP-hard problems has a bad name. Namely, based on the idea of NP-hard as a theory of the 70s. So in the 70s, if something is NP-hard, it's like a stamp of death. That we cannot solve the problem, really. It meant intractable. This is what it meant. And as a result, you know, culture is very hard to change. I have found. I now have white hair. I have observed that to be the case. So as a result, during this period, the computers and algorithms have improved amazingly much. For example, From 90, I was a graduate student. I graduated in 1988, so I have witnessed this. This is not hearsay. It's not my work, but I have witnessed it. The acceleration due to hardware and software improvement for optimization is in the trillions, about 3 to 4 trillion times. Something that used to take 3 to 4 trillion seconds about 30 years ago, it now takes 1 second. I'm dead serious about it. I mean, you know, this is true. That is, and not only is this true, of course, I haven't never waited 33 trillion, but I have witnessed applications where this is the case. So optimization has made significant. So, but the beliefs of NP hardness have not changed because culture doesn't change. I think there is time to view this new era of optimization and what is difficult and what is intractable under the lens of the fact that we have, you know, either very advanced conventional weapons or maybe nuclear weapons at our disposal. So I think we should revisit that view. And this work is in this direction. So here's the punchline. So as you know, maybe I don't know if you know, but the best methods around these days for machine learning, for prediction, either classification or regression, do not typically involve one tree. So the blue, the red is CART. This is 60 real-world problems, from small to large, small few hundred points, large maybe 500,000 points. That's roughly the size. These are real-world problems. And we did not select them for any purpose. We just select 60 large problems from the Irvine database. So this is as a function of the depth of the tree, the out-of-sample accuracy. The red is CART. The blue is optimal classification trees. So they add about 1.2% over on average. And then optimal classification is with hyperplanes, they add about another maybe 3-4%. So a very important question that always puzzled me is that Leo Bryman himself generated his second most important work, was what's called random forest. What is random forest? Random forest is taking a collection of the points randomly and a collection of the features, also randomly, create one tree. Repeat. Another random selection, another random selection of variables, a second tree. You take 1,000 such trees and you average, that's the output. And random forest has long been considered as a much more accurate method of prediction than CART, but uninterpretable. And in some ways, there are some human similarities. So in a way, we as humans have different experiences. So in a sense, we simulate that. And also, we like, especially in academia, we like decisions by committees. So random forest is deciding by committee, right? You average the decisions, and God knows what happens. But it's definitely uninterpretable. If you ask a committee, what did you decide that? Harder. Sometimes, not so hard. But often. So this is the case of random forest. So it always puzzled me that that random forest, it was a fact, it is stronger, but and people said, well, yeah, it's the nature of the methods and so forth. And I was always wondering, is there a tree that can do better? So you have an ace, in other words, you have a Michael Jordan. Can a Michael Jordan do better than a very good but not excellent team? Or 5 Michael Jordans to be. So, and then there was an even stronger improvement of boosted trees, smarter than random. In other words, you take the first random tree, you see where it fails, and then you build a second tree that tries to correct the second one, and then you continue this way. That's called boosted trees. And if you look at Kaggle competitions, almost every winner is a boosted tree. Still uninterpretable, but slightly better, adaptively learning. And this is where they are. So this one is random forest. This is boosted trees. They are stronger than classification trees with vertical and horizontal hyperplanes, but they are slightly weaker or about the same level as one tree, which is hyperplanes. I find this to be interesting. It is fair to say that a hyperplane tree is less interpretable, but at least it's one tree. And the reason it's less interpretable, but you would say, you go to the doctor and says, it's twice your blood pressure plus three times your temperature, less than 170. For most humans, that's unintended. For us, maybe it makes some sense. But, you know, from a cousin of mine who doesn't have any mathematical education, I said, what the hell is he talking about? But it's more understandable. Most importantly, if something doesn't work, so let's say you see the trajectory of this tree, and you say, for this type, let's say you have a new instance, and the data that you have from this instance are not, have typically wrong labels, and the algorithm doesn't do a good job in that. At least you know how you got it, you know what are the variables that were involved, you have a chance of fixing it. If it's an averaging effect, it's much tougher. Having tried, I can assure you that's the case. So in other words, key message is that these trees have the advantage of being more interpretable, and I would say the blue is as interpretable as CART, and you add improved performance, and the hyperplane trees are less interpretable, but more interpretable than others, and they hold their own. I mean, I would not argue whether 0.5% improvement is material in practice, but there's something else that is interesting. Look at the depth at which this happens. You don't need gigantic depths. You need depth 3 or 4 to basically have a reasonable effect. So if you have depth 4, for example, you have 2^4, 16 leaves. It's not trivial, but it's not like you have depth 20. You have 2^20 leaves, which is much harder. It's a much harder story. So the next natural question is, how about neural networks? Right? That's a reasonable question. First of all, in direct competition of, I'm not talking about vision, but in examples, the ones that can address the boosted trees address, I would say boosted trees and neural networks are comparable. They are not night and day. Yeah? So, but this is now a formal theorem. So this is a recent work a few months ago, where we prove mathematically the following, that an optimal classification and regression trees, you give me a neural network, either feed-forward, convolutional, or recurrent, right? Whose functions are, we don't allow these nonlinear functions, but maximum and LLU functions and so forth. So we can find an optimal classification tree, but with hyperplanes, we need that, that has exactly the same performance in sample. And also it can simulate the neural network. So from a theoretical perspective, they have the same power. However, this is not particularly significant. What is the issue, practically speaking? Because neural networks have, in certain applications, quite strong performance. Not in all applications, but in many applications. So we have tried of the order of 30. It's ongoing work. We haven't finished it yet. But on the practical side. So we have found they are very comparable. So at the time I wrote the slides, we had maybe 7 data sets, very large data sets, and very large networks, and they were quite comparable. In 2 of them, I would say the trees were stronger, and the other 5 were almost the same. We have slowly looking into vision, and in the vision case, neural networks have an edge at the moment. So we are trying, but we have closed the gap quite a bit, but there is still a gap on that. So the reason I think this is relevant is because even if you have approximately the same performance, or even a bit worse, but approximately materially similar, and you have something you understand, I think this has, in practical environments, as I will try to argue for the rest of the talk, a significant impact. And you will see in a minute what I mean by that. Yes, sir?
Quick question. I mean, I've seen this kind of theorems before, but there's a blow-up.
There is a blow-up. Indeed, you can. But this is theory. There is theory and this is practice. And here's the practice. Look at what this says. That to get empirical performance that is of high quality, you don't need a lot of depth. To prove the mathematical formulation, I understood and I responded. So, namely, it is indeed, there is a blow up in the theory. But to me, this is basically indicating that you are not losing theoretical power. And on practice, what I have seen is you don't need gigantic depths to that the theory would require for an exact to have materially similar performance for a large number of applications. That's what I'm saying. Okay? So let me start using some examples and why I advocate this trees. So this is an example that is currently in use at Mass General Hospital about emergency care patients. So suppose you have an emergency, you have a person who is in a coma and you bring them to the emergency department. The person cannot even talk. But people of course get information about the patient prior to doing anything. You know, the vitals, the various characteristics and so forth. And the question is, can you assess, and you have a plan about what to do with the patient, what kind of surgery and so forth. But before you execute the plan, and given the data that you have, can you assess the probability of morbidity? The person dies within 30 days. Mortality, I meant. The probability of mortality, or some serious complication, or any complication. That's relevant. Because let's say you do the calculation, humans have a sense how complex the thing is. But I do not believe humans, particularly doctors, but this is generally humans, can really distinguish between 20% and 70%. I mean, I have empirical evidence of the statement. That is, it's a high probability of death, but 70 and 20 are different, right? It's very different what you say to the family, for example, but nobody knows. Except that these methods, if you have a lot of data, we got data from the entire national database for emergency, and this is now we're doing it for selective surgeries. We can build a tree, the details of this is for another conference, but it's definitely understandable by doctors. Just to illustrate, in fact, there is an app. It's a free app that if you like. So it's called POTTER, P-O-T-T-E-R, P-O-T-T-E-R. It's both on the, that we created an app for doctors that you can input. A tree has the advantage that you can ask the questions sequentially. So you say, for example, is the person ventilated? So the person cannot breathe on their own. Let's say the answer is yes. What is the age of the person? The next question, 60 years old. What is the INR, a liver enzyme? 2.3, let's say. What is another enzyme? 1.1. The probability is 42%. So that's an example that even I understand. I educate myself a little bit about what these things mean. But the key here is doctors understand. And the reason sort of they believe it is because it fits their intuition. They don't know if it's 40% or 20%, but they know it's not 0% or 0.01%. It's a high probability for these patients. So we developed it jointly with the trauma department at Mass General. So that's... And on that, I have to believe without interpretability, I don't think we'll have made progress. Because I don't believe that doctors will change their actions on things they don't understand. I mean, I know that I wouldn't change my actions on things I don't understand. Why should I expect others to do the same? Question so far? Yes, I say that.
But then, are you planning anything about the optimization, like what's easier or harder to find?
I don't claim that. I state a mathematical theorem. I say I have model A and I can find model B that simulates it. Claim one.
The exact same function.
At the moment. Because, to be honest, in practice, 1% improvement, if you have 1% lower performance but interpretable, in my experience, it would win any day in doctors. You see what I meant? I exited the world of neural networks, my friend. Right? I'm now into the trees, back to the trees land. Yeah? Yes, sir. They are not necessarily binary. In my world, they are binary. Of course, yeah. From one? Not very significant, because you can simulate a non-binary tree with a binary, but with increase of depth. But you see, if you overdo it with a gigantic tree, it also stops. I have found the human, so this is really tailored for interpretability. After all, the title of my talk is Interpretable AI, right? So mathematically, not much happens. Computationally, of course, if you have very broad trees, it's also, you know, the complexity increases. But I'm in the world of binary trees, and all my statements are about that. General trees can be simulated by binary trees at the expense of depth. Yes? And regressions, yes, same results. Understanding what regression means? I put some constraint, namely that the neural network function is an RLU function, has maximums, or I don't know if you are familiar with Jonathan, but it doesn't cover, for example, sinusoidal functions. It doesn't cover that. But just to mention, neural networks have been proposed in the beginning with this kind of functions. The reason we use is to address the non-differentiability aspects. And the analogy with neurons, it's not, you know, it's a convenience to utilize this. We don't cover that. Yeah? Okay, second application, similar application, mortality and morbidity for cancer patients. This is actually motivated by a story about my family. So my father was diagnosed in 2007 with cancer. And unfortunately, it has spread outside the area. It was not operable. So the only possibility was chemotherapy. And the doctors, you know, he came to the United States, and they were giving him chemotherapy, even at the very latest part of his life. Like 2 weeks before he died, they were, I mean, with good intentions. I mean, I'm not saying. But they were giving chemotherapy. It was obvious to me that it was near the end of his life. It wasn't correct to give him these things. So this is motivated by that. So this is basically the following. Somebody comes, every time you deliver chemotherapy to a patient, you have to see whether the patient is healthy to accept the chemotherapy. So at that point, just before the delivery of chemotherapy, you take the vitals, you take all the exams, and then the doctor makes a decision about giving chemotherapy or not giving chemotherapy. So again, the probability of mortality, humans are not good at this. We cannot assess. I know it personally, I have observed. I mean, they cannot assess that. In my opinion, the probability was 95% that my father would die in a month, and the person thought it was almost zero to justify, because I had a long discussion and disagreement with the doctor. So this does exactly that. Uses trees to assess that probability. It doesn't decide what to do, but if you say to a doctor, based on data from, Dana-Farber is the largest oncology hospital in Boston. We have data from about 250,000 in the last maybe 15 years of Dana-Farber, and this is the output of all these patients. In other words, this is not other patients, this is Dana-Farber patients. This is what they do, right? So this is, in a way, systematizing the outcomes of that hospital. And what it says is that it's an objective way of estimating probability of mortality. And the action is doctors who decide if the probability is too high, enough is enough. So that's the application. Again, trees are relevant in that. Again, an app that is currently utilized at Dana-Farber. Here's another application, also medical, which I find quite impressive. So this is liver transplantation in the United States. So liver disease is a significant disease. And unfortunately, unlike kidneys, that there's dialysis and therefore you can extend life, if you have liver disease of significance, the only cure, postponement, you know, elongating life, is to get a transplanted organ from a patient who dies. Yeah? And the question is, who gets it? It's a pretty serious decision. So specifically, they currently use a regression model to estimate the probability of death. They take some enzymes. It's called MELD, M-E-L-D. The idea is that the organ belongs to the nation, doesn't belong, it's not, there are no money transactions here, belongs to the nation. The nation has algorithms, in this case MELD, to decide who gets the organ. That's the algorithm today. Yeah? Now, so, and it works reasonably well, much better over a decade. But it never has been the case that a machine learning method has been developed to explicitly compute the probability of death. And using trees, we have developed a method that is capable of doing exactly that. And it's sizably more accurate than the current method. The nation uses a simulator, not our simulator, to, if somebody proposes any change, then there's a simulator that analyzes how many deaths, how many people have to travel, and so forth. And what we have found, using this simulation, it averts about 400 deaths. This more accurate method. And how does it do that? So let's say there are three people, right? And it gives it to person A, our algorithm. That is objectively, more accurately predicts the probability of death versus person B that under the MELD score, the MELD score is higher. So person A most likely will die because it's correct. The algorithm is more accurate. If person A gets the organ, person B has actually more life in front, so there is a higher probability that another organ will come later, so that both A and B, their deaths are averted, whereas in the former case, only one of them is averted.
You averted 400 deaths per year. How many deaths per year are there?
There are about 4,000 transplantations of that order, 3,800, you know, about 4,000. That's a hard statistic. These are people who are in the queue. So the people in the queue is of the order much higher number, but the actual transplantations that happen today is about 4,000. And we can do 4,000, we can avert 4,000. I mean, there are two types of deaths. There are deaths of people who are waiting and don't get the organ, and there are people who get an organ that doesn't fit as well. So I'm talking about deaths related to avoiding people who wait.
So that's presumably a fair way to measure, because if there were a million people, you could only do 4,000 transplants, then you're not responsible for the deaths.
No, there are significant ethical questions about this. I don't try to put them aside. But our objective, as it is the nation's objective, is to maximize life in a way that is fair. Namely, that no more men get disproportionate, no blacks, no, you know. If you look at the committee, UNOS, who does this, there are serious ethicists and so forth. I'm actually under the impression that the chair of the committee is from Princeton. I'm not 100%, but I'm pretty certain of that. So this is just to illustrate that utilize, I mean, and why it is interpretable. I don't know if you ever have tried to convince a committee of doctors, many of them are ethicists, to change policy. Has anybody tried? No. I can tell you, you go with a black box, I don't think you will have more than a few seconds to talk. Because, you know, you have to understand. You have to understand what it is that you are saying about things that are life and death significant. That has been my experience. It's not hearsay. This is my own personal experience on these matters, that understanding is important. So that you don't think that the only application of this is healthcare, and since I met John Mulvey in the before, I'd like to give you a financial application. So this is an application with a large bank in Canada. And this is the following idea. So can you understand behavior from transactions? Yeah? So a large bank typically has multiple relations with a customer. They have a mortgage, they have a bank account, they have an IRA, they have various things, they have various accounts. So, question, can you, from the totality of their account, the credit card account, can you understand from their their transactions only, no communications, what is their objective? Are they interested in buying a home? Are they interested to retire? Are they interested in sending the children to college? There are many questions one can. Once you understand their objectives, and then create a financial plan to help them. So this addresses the first question, understanding their objectives from the totality of their accounts. And the reason interpretability matters here is because who delivers this advice? Right. Most people want a human to talk to them for many reasons, one of which is that people are generally idle. They don't want to act. So there's a tree structure that understands this probability, sort of has performance similar to other methods one can try, like random forest and others. But most importantly, it's understandable to people. And therefore you say, Mr. Smith, we propose to you to open this account and this account because we feel your actions suggest this. So it's a much more detailed discussion about what your actions suggest as opposed to what you tell them. And the bank has found that engaging customers that way leads to far better results than going blind, because it's far more informed. So I have 1 minute or a few minutes or so. I would like to tell you a very recent work is about prescriptive trees. Most of machine learning has focused primarily on predictions. I have been only talking about predictions so far. But if you think about what the real problem is prescriptions. We have to make decisions about things. For example, I work these days on personalized medicine, and the key decision, let's say you have a diabetic patient, you have characteristics of the patient, and you need to decide which drug to give the person, or none at all. Do you give insulin, metformin, sulfonylurea, or nothing? So there's a decision there. So the objective is not to predict what the glucose level would be, but the key aspect is what drug to offer. So, and I would like to see, operational research has primarily moved into this is the problem of decisions, of course, is at the fundamental topic of optimization. And if you think about optimization, I'm responsible for that. Optimization starts with a model. I teach a linear programming course at MIT. It starts with a model. It doesn't start with data, right? Here's a model, so we have a view of the world. We pull the model, and then we just make decisions. After the fact, we perhaps look at data and so forth. But really, data, in my opinion, in OR courses, is not the protagonist. It's at best a secondary player. In machine learning, on the other hand, data is a protagonist, but the output is primarily a prediction, not a decision. So what this tries to do is tries to go from data to decisions. The model is non-parametric models like trees. There is still a model. It's not like, but the protagonist is data and decisions. So how do we do it? I'll just tell you. So that's the only equation I have. I think I should have at least one equation. After all, I'm talking to an optimization. but here's the idea. So what it tries to do, so what is the key problem let's say in medicine? Is we don't know the counterfactuals. We do not know what would have happened. Let's say we have data and we know this person took insulin. We know what happened to this person. What we don't know is what would have happened to the same person if this person took metformin. It's not in the data. Yeah? So one possibility is to try to predict the counterfactuals. You have a person and you have data and you try to predict. In a way, this predicts the counterfactual. But what we have found, a better idea, is to try to do them at once. Namely, you have a second term, which is really penalizing the inaccuracy of your prediction. So you simultaneously try to decide decisions as well as the counterfactuals together. The first term, and I recognize in real time I would not have followed what I'm saying, but at least you get a sense that, that the objective function, you use the predictive tree's idea, after all, we can scale this, but with a different objective. The objective is to maximize some portion outcomes, minimize glucose. That's the first part. And the second part, have more accurate trees. Yeah? So it just changes the objective. And if you do it like that, our experience has been that this works very strongly. There has been some recent work on causal forest by a fellow from Stanford, and Stanford people, Afe and Wager, I think. And high quality method, but black box. So this actually competes and beats actually often this thing, and it's understandable. It's one tree. So in other words, I can show to the doctor using prescriptive trees, give insulin to this person, and an explanation of why I believe this to be the case. Because I can trace how, why I believe what I believe. So the doctor might say, what the hell are you talking about? But at least he has a chance to say that, because he understands the nature of the prediction. So we've done some experiments and so forth. Just to conclude, so that I'm 1 minute. So I argued that interpretability matters. I postulated one model that I think has interpretability characteristics and has state-of-the-art predictions, so you don't have to compromise. Prescriptive trees also provide strong prescriptions. I have found that interesting applications, particularly in medicine, but as well as other fields, we have tried computer security, financial services, drug discovery, among many others. Interpretability is something that people want. I also think, I mean, typically when I do research, I always think, what is the implication in teaching? And in my view, there are two conclusions I have reached, and I, at least I'm trying to implement them. The first conclusion is, we should rethink how to teach optimization. We are too much model-based, and I think that's not correct. That is, we need to increase data in our courses. I have some specific, and it's not just to do it's to be much more integrated with data. I would say there's an opportunity on that, and new emerging techniques that could be useful to teach. And finally, I also believe that you can, this was an example, but this is part of a broader piece of work on how to approach machine learning from an optimization perspective. I'm teaching a class as we speak with this title, Machine Learning Under a Modern Optimization Lens, and preparing a book on the subject. But I do believe the field of machine learning could benefit from a more serious optimization. It's not that optimization is not being used, but if you think about the neural network community, what do they use? They use stochastic gradients, more or less. Index of programming, I wouldn't say it is utilized in a significant way, if at all. And many others, many others. So clearly there has been correlations, but the correlation is not as high as it can be, and I would say there are opportunities for both fields. And vice versa, there are opportunities for using machine learning in optimization as well, another important topic for another day, maybe the next in 2 years. Thank you.
Thank you, Dimitris, for a fantastic talk. So questions for Dimitris, and if I may, Dimitris, can you please repeat the questions for the camera?
If I understand it, yeah. Yes, sir. I have heard this before, I don't buy it. What evidence do we have when we don't know the global optimum? I didn't repeat the question, but that's not your question. Yeah.
So my question was, here in optimal classification trees, where we very necessarily are at the global optimum, how do you see that?
Yeah, I'm not, so global optimality, the question is about global optimality in these methods. Global optimality is something we care about. The machine learning community doesn't care about this, and boy, has made a lot of progress in the, the NIPS conference are sold out. I don't see our optimization problems being sold out. I say global optimality is important to us. In essence, I need to prove to you that I'm very smart and I've done the best I can and nobody else can beat me. But perhaps we care, but the world doesn't care. In the end of the day, I think what matters is to utilize, to find solutions that make an impact in practice. That's my objective. And I have found that guiding by rigorous optimization can lead to this goal, even if I don't get the absolute global optimum. but very near there. Because there's also practical aspects of how much time it takes and so forth. So these methods, often they have a guarantee, sometimes they don't have a guarantee. They have a guarantee, the guarantee is not zero, right? But I think it's okay for practical purposes. Yes?
So a very large portion of the talk is about interpretability.
As the title suggested, no?
Yes, it is.
I did not misrepresent it.
But the question is, do we have, and I'm sure there are a lot of studies, what humans do find to be interpretable and what they don't find to be interpretable. It is clear that OCT, for example, is more interpretable for the human than OCTH.
I acknowledge.
Somebody else.
Yeah. So that's a comment, not a question, right?
I'm asking whether or not you believe that to make additional progress, you need to look at the psychological literature and what humans find to be interpretable.
Potentially. My objective. So what is my objective as a scientist? I would like what I do to have an impact in the real world. Not to publish a paper. I mean, publishing paper is a step in this direction. But that's my objective. I have found from experience over 30 years that unless the decision maker understands the decision, what is it that you are saying, it's hard to make progress with impact. That has been my real life experience. So, I mean, I'm not saying this is the only interpretable method. I'm not saying that. I say my message is that optimization is capable of solving problems where interpretability, however you define it. Maybe trees that are not binary, other things as well. I'm not saying there are, you know, there's a lot of human intelligence is distributed. I would say this is number one, a useful characteristic, practically useful for impact. Number two, optimization can help you in this direction. That's my point. On that, I agree. I think you agree, Alex. I do, but I don't know if it's useful yet. Yeah. But we agree on our classification. So?
Okay, in the interest of time, let's maybe take one more quick question. Sanjeev.
So, I often try to think along your lines, and where I always get stuck is that if you use optimization, it seems like you often need a variable for each field, and then generalization all of those other things.
No. Of course, it's correct what you say. So the question is, I think you give me credit, I'm a bit smarter than that. So what Sanjeev said is that, well, if you have each variable for each point and you classify each point in sample, you can have zero error in sample, but zero generalization error, sort of. Of course, we don't do that. Breiman has already found that out, how to do. You basically say, I need leaves that have at least so many points.
Oh, I didn't mean just for decision trees. In general, for doing machine learning development. That's my point.
You put constraints, I mean, depending on the application, but you put constraints that make sense in the case. For example, for trees, you put bounds. Pick your method, I'll tell you. Neural nets. Okay. So, I'm not a huge fan, but the people who do this are smart people. So, they are overdoing it with the size of the tree. So, there's something I don't understand on neural networks, and I have found this. So, people use gigantic neural nets. I mean, gigantic to compute it. And with not these constructions demonstrate that this is not, it's unnecessary, right? The constructions give you intuition that all of this gigantic size that people do is unnecessary, mathematically unnecessary. The construction says that there's a smaller neural network that does it. But I have not yet advocated to solve neural networks with optimization. I haven't tried that yet. I do not know if it's feasible to do. I mean, I don't have. You picked an area that I have not done optimization, but in many others, I have seen ways to reasonable. I don't have a general theory how to do it You are a theoretician, my friend. You want the general theory of everything. In physics, it hasn't been yet. Yeah, but I would say working examples, one can make progress on that. That's my answer. It's a good question.
Thank you for the great questions. I'm going to stop the questions now. Let's thank Dimitris again for a wonderful talk.